the difference between knowledge of what God knows and what we know are at infinite polar axes that are in the opposite direction. And yet on Sunday, he just gives us a little glimmer of the mystery of who he is and what he is doing. And as he calls us to experience and understand his mysterious ways, can I ask all of us who are able to stand and arise with me as we hear the call to worship coming from Romans chapter 11, verse 33 through 36. Oh, the depth of the riches and the wisdom and the knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. Would you join your hearts with mine in a word of prayer? Father God, as we come before you this morning, we seek to understand the mystery of the gospel, this good news that you keep telling us about. We ask, Father, that your Spirit would enlighten our hearts and minds to be able to receive the depth, the richness of what you're truly doing and accomplishing here on this earth. Give us a heart of wonder, give us a heart of awe, give us a heart of praise as we come before you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The risen King, Jesus, shine your light. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Is overwhelmed.
If my heart is overwhelmed and I cannot hear your voice, I'll hold on to what is true, though I cannot see. If the storms of life they come and the road ahead gets steep, I will lift these hands in faith. Remind myself of all that you've done and the life I have because of your Son. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours. I am forever yours. High or valley low, I sing out and remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever yours.
When my heart
is filled with hope, every promise comes my way. When I feel your hands of grace rest upon me, staying desperate for you, God, staying humbled at your feet, I will lift these hands in praise. I will believe. I remind myself of all that you've done in the life I have because of your Son. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours. I am forever yours. Mountain high or valley low, I sing out, remind my soul. I am yours. I am forever yours.
I am yours.
Remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever yours.
Sing that again.
Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours. I am forever yours.
Mountain
high or valley low, I sing out, remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever yours. great the chasm.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Then came the morning.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Yeah.
Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have
That endures throughout generations, Father God. I just pray that you would allow us to really just understand the glory of your presence, Father God, and just the glory and the comfort that is being your children, Father God. I pray this time you would just bless our worship, that you would bless our learning, that you would just allow us to hear what you want us to hear through your servant, Pastor Joe, Father God. I just pray that we would just leave this place just seeking more of you, Father God, and seeking just to be close to you and to be your children. I just pray thank you again for this time. And I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please be seated. Now brings us to the portion of our worship where we call the confession of sin. And the reason why we do this is because, you know, as the call to worship tells us, that God's knowledge, the depth of it, is far greater than ours, which means there's something that we're probably missing in our own lives, something we need to reassess in our own in our own hearts. And to help guide us in that time, just one verse for us from Romans chapter 2, verse 4. Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? You know, this whole idea of repentance, it's provoked by God's kindness, not his nagging, his kindness. And the act of repentance itself is his kindness towards us. And as we try to take that in, can you take some time? What am I missing here in my life? Where am I not following God? Confess, do so, confess silently. Let's do so. God's words of grace coming from Romans 5:1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, as we come before you, peace is something we could all use and desperately need. But we thank you that it's not brought in because we make it happen by calming ourselves, doing things to distract ourselves. Rather, we thank you that peace comes through Jesus to reconcile the world to himself by dying on the cross for our sins. This is the kindness we're reminded of, and perhaps this kindness is the only thing that can bring us a sense of peace with our weary, heavy-laden world. Jesus, as we come before you, give us more of this peace as we listen to your words from Pastor Joe. We lift up this time to you, and we pray in Jesus' name, amen. If you guys have your Bibles, you can turn with me to Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 through 29, and Pastor Joe will give a sermon entitled Sons and Daughters in Christ. And as you guys open up there, if the youth group can transition out, and we can also at the same time greet our neighbors around us.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning to those of you who are streaming via live streaming. Good morning. We're continuing our series and the epistle to the Galatians. Last week, we talked about the purposes of the law. This week, we reached the climax, the apex of all Paul has been saying about having a right relationship with God. Right? We learned that we are sons and daughters of the living God through Christ Jesus. Right? For this, we turn to Galatians 3, 26 through 29. Galatians 3, 26 through 29. Hear now the word of God. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abram's offspring, heirs according to promise. The word of God, amen. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Father, it is so easy to just go through the motions, come and go, and come to worship service because we are Christians, but Father, we want to meet you here in this place. We want to hear your voice through the word proclaimed. We want to know your love, Father. We want to experience that love right here. And I pray, Father, as your word is proclaimed, that that may be the case. Pray all these things in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. A couple of days ago, my wife and I were walking, and we came across these two beautiful dogs. One was an Alaskan Husky, and the other one was a Malamute. During the pandemic, my wife and I walked a lot around our previous house and the current house, and one of our joys had been seeing many beautiful, adorable dogs. By the way, there was a dog in our neighborhood by the name of Bentley. His owner said they named him Bentley because they can't own a car, Bentley. They can't afford to own a car, but they can own a dog named Bentley, so they named their dog Bentley. And he is half Akita and half Jindo, and he's huge, but so gentle, so adorable. He's just still when we pet him. And my wife and I like talk about him like as we walk. Like we're like, oh, we're going to see Bentley today. That day, actually, we saw Bentley, but we weren't able to pet him. But we came across these two beautiful dogs. And my wife asked the owners if she could pet them, and they said yes. So she went and approached the Malamute, and the dog was scared of my wife and reproached and recoiled and even peed on the ground. Very interesting enough, right? And the dog owner said that he's a rescue dog and gets scared of people. And the other dog wasn't all right either because he was licking the pee, the other dog. Anyway, both rescue dogs, and there was something a little bit wrong with both of them. I found it very surprising that this big dog, Malamute, right, vicious looking, with blue eyes, wild looking blue eyes, got scared of my tiny wife and peed. I said to my wife, dogs are very fragile creatures. And because my wife loves huskies so much, she asked them how their experience was raising these two dogs. And the owner said they don't recommend them because they shed so much. They're so energetic. But as I was listening to this, I was hoping, wow, these are rescue dogs. But I hope at least they're loved and finding healing in their new owners. Right? Human beings are even more fragile and sensitive in many cases. We crave, we long to be loved. And when we're not loved like we want to be loved, we're scarred, hurt. And sometimes those scars damage us for a lifetime. I remember growing up wondering if I was adopted. Anybody here grow up thinking you were adopted? Raise your hand. Be brave. Okay. So yes. Yeah. There are some of you. Okay. I was like, am I adopted? Well, first of all, please don't misunderstand. There are adopted parents who really, really love their children, right? And praise the Lord for adoption, right? But the thing I was wondering was, does my mom, who says she's my mom, not love me because, in truth, because I was adopted? I was a sensitive kid, and I'm still very sensitive. And what didn't help was that I didn't look anything like my parents, my mom or dad. And even worse, I didn't look anything, close to anything to my brothers. They're all weird looking. Just kidding. My older brother is 6'3", and when he was in high school, he was 6'3" and 145 pounds. Think about that, right? Just all bones. Like you could even see bones when you go like this, right? My younger brother, he had funny bones. Like he could stretch, you know, his fingers all the way back. And we just didn't look like each other. And I was like, are we really brothers? And am I adopted, right? I wanted to be accepted and loved by my mom, but what I experienced from my mom was constant criticism. Okay, let me just say, you know, my mom wasn't always at fault because I was a sinner too, and we had issues in our relationship. But anyway, the extent of encouragement I got from my mom was this: you're only good at studying. That's an encouragement from my mom. And everything else seemed like a criticism, right? One time, when I was in ninth grade, I entered a gospel singing contest and asked my mom to come to the tryout, right? And guess what she said? She said, "You're not good at singing, and I'm not coming." And I was like, wow, okay. But I still went on and sang at the tryout. Guess what? I made it to the next round. Not because I sang well, but because they didn't have enough contestants. They were like, "You all made it." Okay. And then I sang in the contest and I didn't place at all, right? But still, it scarred me. It was very hurtful. Most of us have scars like that, and we need healing. And the best way to find healing is to know and experience the love of God as our Heavenly Father, right? To know and experience the unconditional love of God. Okay, here's our main point of today's sermon. As a result of being in Christ through faith, we are all sons/daughters of God. And we're going to talk about this in two parts. In Christ, all sons. Throughout the epistle to the Galatians, Paul has been concerned about how we can have a right relationship with God. That's been at the forefront of his thought. How can we have a right relationship with God? And he was adamant, it is not through Christ plus law. People are saying, you know, you need to be circumcised, you need to follow the Old Testament law. Paul said, no way, Jose, it is not through law. And he was insistent that it was through faith in Christ Jesus that we have a right relationship with God, right? By the way, you know, recently, right, you know, before this text, we found that there are only two kinds of people in this world, right? People who are under the law. And by the way, because you're under the law, you're cursed because you can never obey the law perfectly. And those who are in Christ. So under the law, cursed because you can never obey the law perfectly in Christ, right? And those who are in Christ are blessed because Jesus took the curse of the law, became curse for us, became a curse for us, and he took our place. And because of that, those of you who are in Christ are sons and daughters of the living God. That's the message that Paul's been trying to hammer into our hearts, right? And being sons and daughters of God is the climax, the apex of this whole argument, right? What he's been trying to say. I saw in the news this week a young lady, I think she was 18, reached the apex of, you know, Himalayas, right? She reached the highest mountain peak. And what Paul is arguing is this is the highest, this is what we are all after. What is the peak? What is the climax? It is that we are sons and daughters of the living God. through faith in Jesus Christ. And in fact, this is the climax of the gospel. Sinclair Ferguson, one of my professors from Westminster, says, the notion that we are the children of God, his own sons and daughters, is the mainspring of Christian living. Our sonship is the apex of creation and the goal of redemption. To know this, to realize this, to be sons and daughters, this is what it's all about. And this is all a result of being in Christ. So let's talk about that, being in Christ. First point, in Christ. Verse 26 says, for in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. The last four verses of Galatians are full of talk about Jesus Christ. We just mentioned verse 26, which talks about being in Christ Jesus. And because we're in Christ Jesus, we're children of God. Verse 27 speaks of being baptized into Christ and putting Christ on or being clothed with Christ. Verse 28 speaks of all the fact that we are all one in Christ. And then finally, verse 29, it says, if you are Christ's or if you belong to Christ, right? It says, then we're children of Abraham. All these are different ways of describing our union with Christ. The fact that if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you are one with Christ. He is in you, you are in him. We are united with Christ. I want to focus on the concept of putting on Christ here, or being clothed with Christ. Okay, so let's talk about that. There are four implications of putting on Christ, or being clothed with Christ. It is sometimes said that clothes make a man. Right? You've heard that saying, right? Clothes make a man. Some ladies love a man in uniform, right? I used to wear a suit all. My wife loves me wearing a suit, right? And on Sundays, I would wear a suit to preach, but I don't get to do that anymore. So she doesn't love me as much. No, just kidding. Our clothing tells us who we are, right? Our clothing shows us gender sometimes, social class sometimes, and even cultural background sometimes, right? To say that Christ is our clothing, then, is to say that our ultimate identity is found in Jesus Christ. Our ultimate identity is found in Jesus Christ. Instead of everything else that you put on, right? Paul says, put on Christ, because he defines who you are. He is the one who defines your identity. Let's be honest, though. We put a lot of facades on, though, right? We pretend to be something we're not, don't we? So often in our walk with Christ, we say we have accepted Christ by faith, and this is all by grace, but we seek to measure up. We often seek to measure up by our works, right? You know, we sang of this great chasm that exists between God. You know, God is holy, right? I mean, I just put my hands up here, but this is infinitely holy, right? God is holy, and we are sinful, and you know, the depth of our sin goes far beyond this hand here, right? There's a great chasm. And what filled that chasm? Your works in the first place? No. It's the cross of Jesus Christ, right? It's his finished work for us. But after we become Christians, we come to recognize, this chasm is a reality. We come to realize this chasm even more. God is so holy and we're such great sinners. That's maturity, right? But instead of saying it is all because of Christ, some of us, we say, oh, I can't fill the chasm between me and my sin and Christ's holiness. So what do? We seek to fill it with our works, and we realize, oh, I can never measure up. Well, we never measured up to begin with. It was by grace alone, by faith in Christ Jesus. It was cross that made all the difference. So what do? We try to fake it. We put on facades. There's a saying, fake it till you make it. But you can't fake it till you make it in Jesus Christ, in our faith, right? You can't. So you put on these false fronts, and we forget that we've been clothed with Christ's righteousness. That's what makes all the difference, right? You don't need to fake it till you make it. You don't need to come before, you know, our brothers and sisters and act all holy when you're not, right? Why? Because your works doesn't make the difference. What makes the difference is Christ and his finished work. And so we can be very, very, very vulnerable here. So we can share what our struggles are. Because it's not me that filled the chasm, right? I could talk more about that, but let's move on to second aspect, implication of being clothed with Christ. The idea of putting Christ on, being clothed with Christ, also suggests the closeness of our relationship with Christ, right? So what is closest to you now? It's not the person next to you. It's the clothes that you put on, right? It's the closest to you today. Your clothes touch your skin. And you go everywhere with clothes, unless you're nudist, okay? But thankfully, there are no nudists in this church, right? Christ is present with you. He goes everywhere you go, right? That's the idea. You know, when I talk about this, I'm reminded of a security blanket. When I lived in the Middle East, you know, I loved baby ever since I was little. Even in elementary school, I was in elementary school in Dubai, and there was this baby I just adored holding him. But except for one thing, right? He loved this security blanket, and he wouldn't let it go. He would cry if somebody tried to take it away. He would sleep with it on it. And so, you know, usually some mothers, you know, they try to, like, take it away secretly when they're sleeping and wash it and put it back. This mother was not successful in doing that. So guess what? This blanket was filthy and smelly, right? So I love coming and, you know, holding the baby, but the baby won't let go of the blanket, which was stinky and dirty, right? Well, you know, Jesus Christ is better than that security blanket. He is with us everywhere. He provides a true security. And we, you know, we are with him everywhere we go. He is with us everywhere we go. That's what it means to be clothed with Christ. And to practice the presence of Christ means that we continually think and act as if we're before his face. Old Testament talks about walking before God. Walking before, like right before God. The reformers talked about the idea of coram Deo, living before his presence. Right? It means to take Jesus into every area of life and change it according to his will and the Spirit, Holy Spirit. We are to put on the virtues of Christ, right? Ephesians 4 talks about how we need to put off, take off our old self and put on, right, clothe ourselves with new creation in Christ Jesus. Finally, clothing is it worn as an adornment to cover our nakedness, right? Unless you're nudist, again. But God has been providing clothes which cover our shames ever since the fall, right? You know, I haven't been stumped too much lately because, you know, I've dealt with so many questions over the years as a pastor. But recently in our baptism class, very recently, I was stumped. One person asked me, "Oh, Pastor Joe, is Adam and Eve in heaven?" And I was like, "Whoa, what is it? I've never really thought about that. Nobody ever asked me that question." I always talk about Adam and Eve's fall, and because of Adam and Eve, you know, we're all made, you know, born sinners, and I hate Adam for it. But we don't talk about the fact that Adam and Eve is in heaven or anything like that, right? So I got stumped. So what do you do? Right during the baptism class, I said, "Let's Google it." So we Googled, and it's okay. I mean, I don't know all things. We Googled, and we found that, you know, I Googled R.C. Sproul, you know, a famous Reformed theologian, and R.C. Sproul said that yes, he thinks that they're in heaven. Why? Because of the concept of being clothed, right? What happened with Adam and Eve? God killed an animal and clothed them with animal skins, right? And R.C. Sproul said that points to us being clothed with Christ's righteousness. And that's a picture of you know, us being clothed with Christ's righteousness. So R.C. Sproul thinks that Adam and Eve are in heaven, right? So I was able to give that answer to that person. So what is this idea of being clothed? It means that our shame has been covered by what Jesus Christ did. Jesus clothed us with his own righteousness. On the cross, right, Jesus took upon himself our sin and became sin for us. He who knew no sin, 2 Corinthians says, became sin for us, right? And those who put their faith in Jesus Christ, what does Christ do? He gives you his righteousness. We call this double imputation. So Jesus takes our sin upon himself on the cross, and on the cross, for those of us who put our faith in him, because of his perfect righteousness, because of his perfect obedience, he is able to credit, impute that righteousness to you and to me. So when the Father sees you, who does he see? He sees his Son. He sees his Son's righteousness. And because he sees his Son in you, he considers you sons. We are all sons. And we come to our second point. All sons. Again, verse 26 says, for in Jesus Christ, and the second part is what we're focusing on now, for in Jesus Christ, you are all sons of God through faith. Liberal theologians used to say this, you know, the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. The fatherhood of God and brotherhood of man. Remember, I talked to you about this, right? That liberal Protestant denominations, like liberal Presbyterian denominations, used to send out missionaries with this concept. Oh, yeah, we're all brothers and sisters, and God is everybody's father. So they didn't even bother with the gospel message. They just lived among them, served them. Some even became monks, right, of a different religion in the name of missions. Makes no sense, right? But that's the danger of this idea. Oh, yeah, God is father of everybody. We're all brother. There's some sense of truth to that because, yeah, we're all created by God. We're all his creatures, and we belong to the common humanity. But there is this very special idea that we are the children of the living God. The sonship is a privilege granted specifically those who come to God in faith. This only comes to those who are in Christ Jesus. Let me say what Phil Reichen says. Although God is creator of all, ruler of all, and judge of all, he is the father only of his Son, Jesus Christ. And he emphasized that. He is father of his Son, only his Son, Jesus Christ, and those who are in Christ by faith. Right? So he is our father in a very unique way. Tim Keller says in his commentary on Galatians, many take offense at using the masculine term sons here. That's what Paul used. And theologians refer to this concept as sonship. And it refers to both male and female. You are sons. You are all sons. That's why I just left it there, all sons, even though I explained we're all sons and / daughters. I left it all sons on purpose. Why? Because there is a revolutionary idea that has been communicated by that concept. But, you know, translations like NIV translate like you are children of God to remove the offense. But there shouldn't be offense. Listen to what I'm saying. If we're quick to change the biblical language, Tim Keller says, we miss the revolutionary and radically egalitarian nature of what Paul is saying. In ancient cultures, daughters could never inherit property, right? Sons were up here. Daughters were considered below here, right? Second-class citizens. Therefore, sons meant here a legal heir, which was a status forbidden to women. But the gospel tells us that we are all sons. So what Paul is trying to do with this phrase, and you shouldn't be offended, you should be thankful when he says sons, we're all sons, is saying we're all equal in God's eyes. We're all heirs in God's eyes. After all, the Bible describes all Christians together, including men, as bride of Christ. Not the most exciting thought for many people. And he, you know, he says so in Revelation 21:20. Let me tell you. Let's tell the guys in our room, you are a bride of Christ. Okay, you don't have to do that. Let's go. Let's move on. Yeah. Some people are looking strange. Anyway, so the emphasis here is we're all sons, right? All equal. We're all heirs. And we're loved. I mean, just think about, you know, grandparents, right? You know, my father, for example, and mother kept telling my older brother who had two daughters, you need to have one more child. Kept saying, you need to have one more child. And then we only had one son. They never said, you need to have one more child. Guess what they were saying? You need to have a son. You need to have a son. I mean, not just my parents, my in-laws. Guess what my mother-in-law wants? She wants grandsons. I mean, you know, so it's not just an ancient Near Eastern thing. It's a common, prevalent thing. But Paul says we're all sons in Christ Jesus. And the connection with Jesus, the Son, should not be missed. And that's why we should keep the concept of sonship. The Father loves you as he loves his very own Son. That's the idea behind sonship. And with that in mind, are you living your life today as a son or an orphan? There's a book we studied in our KG some years ago entitled Sonship. Great book. And in this book, it says that we often live as orphans when we are children of God. Listen to what it says. A believer is living as an orphan when he or she has somehow lost touch with the grace of God. In isolation from the promises, the orphan has developed a small view of Christ and a small view of the gospel. In contrast, the believer is living as a son or daughter when he or she is walking in faith and living in accordance with God's promises. Sons and daughters have a large view of Christ and a large view of the gospel. Right? So let me put you to a test, okay? I'm going to list two categories of things, right? How an orphan, let's take this as a category for orphans, right? How orphans think, and how sons and daughters think, if you are living out the sonship in Jesus Christ, okay? So, orphans. Orphans feel alone, lack of vital daily intimacy with God, is full of self-concern. That's an orphan, spiritual orphan. How about sons? Has a growing assurance that God is really my loving Heavenly Father. Very different outlook. Which one are you? Next one, anxious over felt needs, relationship, money, health. I'm all alone and nobody cares. I am not a happy camper. How about the other side, sons and daughters? Trust the Father and has a growing confidence in his loving care, is being freed up from worry. Again, orphans, lives on success-fail basis, needs to look good and right, is performance-oriented. Doesn't that sound familiar? Sons and daughters, learning to live in daily conscious partnership with God, is not fearful. Orphans feels condemned, guilty, and unworthy before God and others. Sons feel loved, forgiven, totally accepted, because Christ's merits really clothe him. Isn't that what we've been talking about? Orphans has little faith, lots of fear, lots of faith in himself. I've got to fix it. Sons, daughters, has a daily walking trust in God's sovereign plan for her life as loving, wise, best, believes God is good. Let me give one more final. Labors under a sense of unlimited obligation, tries too hard to please, you know, people and burn out. Sons, daughters, prayer is the first resort. I'm going to go ask my daddy first. And comes to God saying, Abba, Father. What a difference. But in all honesty, aren't we so much like the orphan? Aren't we living like an orphan? When in truth, we are sons and daughters of the living God. There are two more things that are true because we are in Christ, because we are sons. The first thing is that we are all one in Christ. And the second is that we are Abraham's offspring. First, in verse 28, Paul says, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ. Paul says that there is no distinction of race in Christ. Cultural divisions should not play a part in the Church of Jesus Christ, right? What that means is we need to accept people from all different culture. People of one culture do not need to become like another culture in order to be accepted. What is he talking about? Judaizers, right? Judaizers basically were saying, for you, Gentiles, to become a Christian, you need to be circumcised. You need to become culturally a Jew. That's what they were saying, essentially. But they were going beyond that because, you know, the Jews were concerned about, you know, as far as they were concerned, there were two kinds of people in the world, Jews and the Gentiles. And even after you come to faith, even after you're circumcised, they would have treated you like second-class citizens. But Paul says, God has made us one, right? Yes, God has created us differently. And so different cultures, different races should be celebrated. It's a God thing, right? However, there should be no division because of race. We are one in Christ, okay? Paul also says that there's neither slave nor free. Nearly in every society in history of the world, societies have developed classes or caste systems, right? I mean, we've seen this throughout history. However, class or economic status, Paul says, should not be used to cause a division in the church. People who make less money than us should not be treated any differently than people who make more money than us, right? Just because people make more money, we shouldn't go, oh, there are people who make less money. We shouldn't go, oh, those people. But it's something that can be real in an Asian church like ours, right? Because so many people are professionals that we're used to making a lot of money that we may subconsciously look down upon people who make less money than us. And Paul says that should never be. Paul says also that there is no male or female. Women were nearly always despised in the ancient world. But I say ancient world, but then even in modern world, look at the Taliban, right? And even in Judaism, often women were exploited and ill-treated as well, according to John Stott. But Paul is asserting here that in Christ, male and female are one and equal. And it's very, very interesting because so many people charge Christians as being bigots and anti-feminists, right? When it is Christianity above everything else that brought about equality of men and women. Let me say that again. It's Christianity above anything else. I mean, show me an argument. Tell me what else helped to bring about equality of women and men like Christianity. There's nothing else that has brought about equality like Christianity. There's no one else like Jesus Christ himself who has brought about the value of women than anyone else. And if you want to argue about it, you can come and argue about me that later. But it is historical fact, right? And so being in Christ establishes a fundamental unity within which our diversity can be cherished. Our ethnic, social, and gender distinctions continue to exist. And you know what? We don't say, let's all get rid of them. There are distinctions that should be there, and there are some things that should be celebrated. But since we are in Christ, these distinctions should not divide. They do not determine our standing in God's family. I like how one commentator put it. Let me read what it says. We should see our oneness in Christ not as a leveling and abolishing of all racial, social, and gender differences, but as an integration of just such differences into a common participation in Christ, right? Talking about union with Christ, where they enhance the unity of the body. He says our differences can enhance, right, the unity of the body and enrich the mutual interdependence and service of its members. In other words, it is a oneness because such differences cease to be a barrier and cause of pride or regret or embarrassment and become rather a means to display the diverse richness of God's creation and grace. Yes, our oneness displays the beauty, the richness of God's creation, diversity, both in acceptance of all and in the gifting of each, right? Diversity is celebrated. And then in that diversity, we emphasize oneness. And in our oneness, that diversity becomes even more beautiful. Finally, Paul says in verse 29, and if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. Not only do we belong to God and to each other in Christ, we belong to Abraham. We belong to Abraham. Some of you are like, what's the big deal that we belong to Abraham? My older brother's name is Abraham. My older brother's name is actually Abraham. But what's the big deal? Well, it's saying we take our place in noble historical succession in faith, right? Whose outstanding representatives are listed in the hall of faith in Hebrews 11. I'm very thankful of my Christian heritage. You know, I'm a third generation pastor. But Paul tells me I have a greater heritage than that. Abraham is my father, right? And all those who have come in faith are my fathers and mothers, right? I am one among a great tradition of Christian faith. I'm not alone. You're not alone. You know, even if you happen to be the first amongst, you know, your family to become a Christian, you're not alone, right? You're with this significant legacy of faith that has been carried out throughout history. You are Abram's offspring in Christ Jesus. Let me end with this. Remember, in relation to God, you're a son, a daughter. You are a child of the living God. Amen? And in relation to Christians, people around you, you are a brother, sister to your fellow Christians. And in relation to history, I mean, let's look at history. You belong to the one family God has begun in time and will keep for all of eternity. Isn't that a beautiful thought? You belong to the family of God. John Stott explains this further and says that Christians find their place in eternity. How? You relate first and foremost to God and as his sons and daughters. And you have found a new place in society. You relate to each other as brothers and sisters in the family of God. And finally, in history, we relate also to the succession of God's people down the history. Right? The heroes of faith that you love so much. Yeah, you can claim them as belonging to your legacy of faith, history. I began by saying that we're very fragile creatures, and we are. I don't know what is scarring you, what has hurt you that so bad that is affecting you to this day. The proper way for us to find healing is to live out by faith in your sonship in Christ. Believe what Christ tells you instead of believing in Satan and say, you're not good enough, you're not good enough, Satan would say, you are an orphan. But let me tell you, Christ would say, you are not an orphan. You're a child, you're a son of the living God. Instead of constantly being bruised and scarred emotionally, find healing by knowing and experiencing the love of God. Don't allow that hurt, the trauma, to be the final word in your life. Never allow that to be the case. You need to process all the hurts in your life biblically. You need to process all the things that went into your life in light of the fact that you are a son, you're a daughter of the living God. Allow your loving God to bring healing to your soul. Allow him. Know that your Heavenly Father loves you. And so run to him. Run to him crying out, Abba, Father. Abba, Father. And he will bring about healing. Let me end with this. When Jesus was being baptized, a voice came from heaven. It was God speaking. And he said, this is my beloved son with whom I am very well pleased. You know, we all long to hear that, right? I love you. I'm very well pleased with you. But because of the fact that you are in Christ, when the Father sees you, I said he sees his son. So when the Father sees you, guess what he says? He says, you are my beloved son, daughter. And I am very well pleased with you. Do you hear that? To the extent that we hear God tell you that is the extent to which you will find healing of your soul. Let's pray. Father, it is our prayer that you would help us to know and experience your love. Your love that calls us all sons. Father, who are we that you say that we're sons? This beauty of this gospel truth that when you see us, you see a son. So you say to us, you are my beloved son or daughter. You say to us, I am very well pleased with you. I am proud of you. Help us to hear that from you this day. Lord, speak to us, even now. We pray all these things in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. We're going to respond to the message we've heard and sing of how deep the Father loves us. He allowed his own son to bear the pain of the cross so that we may be sons in glory, right? Let's all stand to respond and sing of his love.
Paid my ransom.
But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
Amen. Please be seated. Let's continue to worship our God through our tithes and offerings. We give in response to the love we received. You know, it's a love offering back because God has poured out His love for us. You can give online, and you can give personally in the box in the back. And for our offering, Elder David will come and pray on behalf of the congregation.
Let us pray. Father God, we're all gathered here together, and we just thank you so much for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We are such fragile people. We are very sensitive to what others think. And oftentimes we get distracted and not realize what's more important. What's more important is our relationship with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We often get swayed by the things that we accomplish and the things that we do and the things that make us feel so boastful and arrogant at times, that we can do everything ourselves. We are our own captain of our ship, our own island that can do everything. But no, you know us better than anyone else. You know that we need our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And through His life and death and resurrection, that provides our meaning, our hope, our future, our faith in the Lord, that we by Him, by His love, that we know what our future will be with You, no matter what it is. I thank You so much that some of us have taken their lives to, all of us have in different ways. We're on our walk to serve You, Lord. But I want to take this time to raise up our missionaries that we support, including Jim and Claudia in Australia. Our mission lives that we have in our daily lives, as we have mission to the daily people that we meet, not just to the third world, but even in the first world, where we think that everything is so modern and everything that, and everyone believes that we don't need the Word of God, the Lord Christ. But we do. Even in Australia, even in our backyard, we need You. So I pray that You support us and help us. I ask that during this time that we do not get so boastful about the things that we do, but also are willing to offer up what we have back to You through our tithes and offerings. I thank You for this time, and help us to grow closer to You and always look upon our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, always in all things. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. It's now time for greetings and announcements. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to those of you who are joining us for the first time. We have our welcoming committee members standing there to greet you. So after the service, we invite you to see them. They can guide you on what our church is all about. If you have any questions, and it's a first step in becoming part of this Hope family, I want to invite you guys to see our welcoming committee. We have, after the service, what we call reflection time. We're going to have reflection groups. Today, we have men-only reflection groups because ladies are going to have their own meeting separately. So, men, let's be excited to have a men-on reflection time. And we're gonna reflect on the message we heard, so that God could continue to heal, right, our scars that we have, right. Next, ladies, please come and join our Women of Hope event today. Today, and the topic is let's talk about sex. The purpose of this event is to remind sisters that they're not alone in their struggles, and that church is a safe place where we can engage in edifying and challenging discussion with compassion and love. We'll meet in cafeteria. Oh, let me go. We'll meet in cafeteria at 12. Lunch will be provided. Even if you didn't RSVP, you're welcome, right? So please, if you are a woman, I'm sorry, guys, you can't go to that one. Ladies, please join so that you guys can talk about, not only talk about this, but live out your oneness, you know, in Christ Jesus as well. It's a wonderful way to fellowship and get to know your sisters. Next, we are, Lord willing, going to have a senior banquet May 28th. It's a Saturday. You know, we haven't had it for the last 2 years, and I feel so bad for the juniors who prepare for the seniors like 2-3 years ago and never got to celebrate, man, and they're all gone. Not all gone, but most of them are gone. It's so sad, but thankfully, Lord willing, we're able to have one this year, so please stay tuned for announcements. Next. We haven't said this one in a long time, but Joey posted, I thought it was wonderful. If you have a mercy need or prayer request, please speak with any of our deacons, deaconesses, or email. There's a prayer link. HopeMercyMinistry@gmail.com. You know, if you need help, you can come out, come and speak to me, and meet with me too. So, you know, I'm available to speak to you as well. So please don't. If you have issues in life, right, scars that you need to deal with, don't go it alone. Come and seek help. We can help each other. Right? Okay. Now, that's it. Let's all stand for the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Receive the blessings from the Lord. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Amen. Go in love, everyone. Let's fellowship outside. There's snacks outside.